Well, we've been going through a series called Luke, and we call it the story of Jesus because that's really what Luke is. Luke picks up right before Jesus' birth. It shows us his parents and what they're experiencing. And then it shows us his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And I told Myron, I said, you know what we should do? We should just keep going on into Acts. We can keep going, you know, verse by verse. We can carry this out for a couple of years. Because, you know, Acts is basically volume 2 of the book of Luke. It's written by the same guy. And we decided to step away from it and do something different for a little while. But we're going to continue on through the book of Luke up through Easter. So you're going to want to be here through the next several weeks. You can read ahead, and there are spoilers. If you read ahead, you can know what the sermons are going to be about. How many of you like spoilers? All right, these are the good kind of spoilers. It's good for you, okay? You can read ahead. This morning, we're going to be in Luke chapter 15. And the scriptures will be up there on the screen. There's Bibles in the chairs, not in the pews, because we don't have pews. And I've worked here 4 years, and I still haven't gotten that right. You can follow along in there, or it'll be up on the screen. Either one, you can follow that along. But this morning in Luke 15, we're going to talk about what it means to be lost and found. How many of you have ever, like, dug through a lost and found bin? All right, now, I'm not going to ask what the creepiest thing you found is, or what the weirdest thing you found is, all right? I'm just going to tell you what the weirdest thing to me is. Almost every lost and found I've ever looked at, there is usually a pair of underwear in it. Has that been your experience? Yeah, okay. Almost always there is a pair of underwear, all right? Now, usually, like, this is at, like, elementary schools with boys that, you know, okay, you get it, all right? But there's underwear for some reason. One of the other things I heard in the first service was, like, one sock or one shoe. Don't that bother you? Like, can you imagine how terrible it is to lose one shoe? Anybody ever lost one shoe? Did you ever find it? No. That's terrible. That's awful, all right? Hopefully the dryer didn't eat it like it eats socks at my house. But anyways, we're going to talk about what it means to be lost and found. And before we actually get into Luke 15, we actually have to go back to Luke 14, where Pastor Myron was preaching last week, and we'll kind of set the stage a little bit. In Luke chapter 14, this isn't up here, so you can just kind of listen to this, but in Luke chapter 14, we find that Jesus has been invited to a banquet at a prominent Pharisee's house, all right? Now, Jesus has talked to a ton of Pharisees in his time on earth, all right? It's kind of his thing, all right? He's talking to a bunch of Pharisees, teachers of the law. In one translation, it calls teachers of the law lawyers, which I think is funny because he's kind of bashing on them a little bit. I just think it's funny that Jesus was making lawyer jokes long before we ever thought of it, okay? But in Luke 14, Jesus has been invited to a banquet at what the scriptures call a prominent Pharisee's house, all right? Now, it doesn't give his name as far as I've found, all right? Maybe you've found some other translation that gives this guy's name. That'd be great. I'd love to talk to you about it later. But I haven't figured out who this guy is yet, but I have some guesses. Do you want to hear my guesses? That's what I get paid for, right? Just stand up here and guess about the Bible, right? But here's my thoughts. If this was a movie, all right, if they make a movie out of this part of Jesus' life someday, it'll be a guy named Nicodemus, who Jesus met earlier in the scriptures, earlier in his time on earth, all right? So it could be Nicodemus. He's a Pharisee. My other thought was, how cool would it be if Jesus sits down with a guy named Saul, who we later come to know as Paul, all right? Because at this time in history, Saul is a guy who is not a fan of Jesus. Saul is looking at Jesus as a blasphemer, a false prophet, all right? But Saul is kind of this smart guy that he might, like, kind of, like, invite him over, and let's see what he has to say, all right? So I could see this being Saul, the guy we come to know later as Paul, all right? In a movie later, it'll be either Nicodemus or Paul, all right? I promise you, if Hollywood ever decides to make a movie out of this, it'll be one of those two guys, all right? And now that this is being recorded, I can get the royalties to that when they come up with that. It's awesome. But in Luke chapter 14, we see that Jesus sits down, and they're having this dinner, and there is a guy there who needs to be healed. His body is swollen. That's really kind of all the details we get about it, all right? I am not a doctor. I have no medical degree. I have no medical experience except, like, taping ankles and stuff and putting on Band-Aids, all right? That's my medical experience. So if you want to know what I think this was, I have no idea. You can talk to Freddie. You can talk to Dr. Mandy sometime later. Somebody smarter than me will know that, all right? But all we know is this guy has some medical problem where parts of his body are, like, swollen. All right, and I'm not a doctor, but that seems like a bad thing, all right, to where, like, if there was a guy that could heal me, I would probably want to talk to that guy. All right, so that's this guy is there. He's got this issue of he's like all swollen and stuff. So Jesus looks at the Pharisees, the teachers of the law, or the lawyers, and he says, I got a question, because this is a Sabbath day. He says, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath? Because, you know, they had laws about you can only do so much work on the Sabbath. So he asks them this question. And they're like stumped, and they don't really know what to say. So Jesus goes and he heals this guy, and they're not happy about that. And here's what I think happens. What we see in the scripture in verse 4 is it says this guy is healed, and then he goes on his way. And that's kind of the last we hear about this guy. But we'll pick it up in verse 15, in chapter 15, verse 1. It says, tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. All right? Now, here's what I know, is that most places in Scripture, when Jesus is changing scenes, he's going from one place to another, it gives us some indication of where he was, all right? Between chapters 14 and 15, there is nothing that says, and Jesus left and went to another place, all right? There's nothing like that. So what we can guess by looking at Luke 15 is we can guess that this story that we're about to read is happening at the same table. All right, so the same place, Jesus is sitting around Pharisees and teachers of the law, a bunch of lawyers, all right, where he's invited to their house. They're not fans of his, and I'm guessing he's not big fans of theirs, you know, as much as Jesus cannot be a fan of somebody, you know, get what I mean? And we pick it up here, and it says, tax collectors and sinners were all gathering around to hear Jesus. All right, now as far as we can tell, this is happening at a Pharisee's house. All right, Pharisees are not fans of tax collectors and sinners, okay? This would be like if a bunch of Carolina fans came over to Patsy's house and gave her a hug, all right? Yeah. If you know Patsy, you know she loves Duke, all right? Which I think there's a showdown coming up.
No, it was.
Oh, it was, all right. See, I'm really plugged into sports, right? Big Ten sports are the only ones that count anyways. But anyways, so we see all of these tax collectors and sinners, they're starting to hang out around the Pharisee's house. And they're probably not none too happy about that. Here's why I think that is. Remember that guy in chapter 14 who Jesus healed? He was a sinner. He's nothing special. He's gone out and he's told people, hey, you know how like my arm used to be like this big? It wasn't because I had giant biceps. It's because Jesus healed me. So he tells his story about Jesus, and people come and they want to hear more from the guy that healed the dude that was swollen. All right, now the scripture doesn't say that, but that's what happens every other time in scripture. So now what we see is there's a bunch of tax collectors and sinners gathering around to hear Jesus. And verse 2 says, but the Pharisees and the teachers of the law muttered, this man welcomes sinners and eats with them. All right, now sorry, I should have done it a little more this way because this is how Pharisees talk when they're muttering. This man welcomes sinners and he eats with them. Now, do you hear the hypocrisy in their voices? All right, check this out. They've invited Jesus into their house, a man who they think is a false prophet and a sinner, a guy who they think is blaspheming God, and they've just invited them into their house to eat with him. And when Jesus has sinners hanging around him that want to hear from him because he's doing amazing things, well, he's welcoming sinners, and he's eating with them too. See, this is why you got to read the Bible, okay? There is good stuff in the Bible, all right? There are things that Jesus does that really angers people, and I think that's funny, all right? Maybe it's because I'm a second born. How many of you are middle children or second born? Okay, some of you know it's fun to mess with people, all right? There's a lot of firstborns in here this morning, I can tell. But here's what we're going to see this morning. I want to back up just a little bit. What we're going to see is we're going to take you through three parables or stories that Jesus tells to illustrate a point. And the point that he's going to illustrate is there is a difference between lost people and found people. All right? Now, he is sitting there with Pharisees, tax collectors, and sinners. All right? So he's got church people, and he's got people who don't go to church. That's essentially what he's got. He's got found people and lost people. All right. Now, these Pharisees are people that they would be like pastors. It's kind of a shame as a pastor to read about the Pharisees and think like, oh, that's like my job. That's like those are the people I identify with in scriptures. That's cool. That's awesome. I love that. But that's the picture we get in the scriptures is the Pharisees are pastors and leaders in the church. It'd be like pastors and board members. So these guys are more of an example of what not to be. But these are guys whose job it is to lead people away from being sinners and lead them into following God, into a relationship with God. So what happens for these Pharisees is they have lost sight of that. They've lost sight of leading people to worship God, and they've begun to lead people to follow a set of rules and regulations and rituals. They've substituted love for God with religious rules. Anybody ever been in a church like that? It's not fun, right? Like, that's why you're here, right? This is good, all right? Hopefully you're not thinking of this church like, oh yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about, all right? We're not perfect, but you know, that's not what we identify with. But that's who these guys are. They've distorted that. They've lost kind of their where they're supposed to be leading people to a relationship with God. So Jesus has these guys, the Pharisees, who are supposed to be leading people, and he's got sinners. And he decides he's going to tell some stories, and he's going to illustrate the differences between them, which I think is funny. You know, it's kind of like if you've got a family and you're sitting around the Thanksgiving table, and you've got, you know, maybe people who are more conservative and maybe people who are more liberal, and you decide to ask a political question, all right? That's kind of what Jesus is doing. He's got people of opposing views, and he's starting to talk about them and show people the differences between them. So let's pick it up. We'll pick it up here in verse 4. Now, I will tell you, these are probably stories, if you've been in church for any length of time, these are like the Bible's greatest hits, okay? I said this in the first service, I'll see if you get it, but this isn't like number 7 on Van Halen's 1984 album, which in my opinion is one of the greatest Van Halen songs ever written. And if you know what that is, I'll be very impressed. So you can tell me about it later. But this isn't that. These are probably stories that you've heard. These are probably pretty familiar stories. So I want you to keep that in mind as we go through this. So we'll pick it up here in verse 4. We see Jesus starts to tell a story or a parable about lost sheep. Anybody ever been a shepherd? Ever raised sheep or led sheep? Cool, a little bit. Okay, me neither, all right? Most of us haven't, all right? That's not a thing that we do. I grew up in Flint, Michigan. I didn't see a sheep in Flint ever, except on TV. But what I know about sheep is, you know, well, the same thing you know about sheep. Sheep are kind of dumb, all right? They're pack animals. They kind of follow each other. They follow the leader. So let's see what Jesus has to say about these lost sheep here. We'll pick it up here in verse 4. Suppose one of you has 100 sheep and loses one of them. Doesn't he leave the 99 in the open country and go after the lost sheep until he finds it? And when he finds it, he joyfully puts it on his shoulders and goes home. Then he calls his friends and neighbors together and says, "Rejoice with me, I have found my lost sheep." And then he posts it on Facebook. Oh, no, he doesn't say Facebook. That's weird. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent. All right? Now, here's what Jesus is doing. Jesus is making a point. He's not saying that, hey, everybody has these 100 sheep and you should abandon 99 of them if just one of them gets lost. What he's saying is, isn't that one sheep important enough to you to leave the others where they are and pursue it and go after it? Because what do we see in Scripture? We see Jesus leaving heaven to come down, enter into our world, and change our lives. Isn't it great when things make noise? It's a great thing of a sound. It's only like 2 of you could hear it, but it's bothering me. But Jesus has come down from heaven. He stepped into our world, and he's gone after us because you and I were those sheep, and that one or two of us that was lost, you know, like if you were the only one that was lost, Jesus thought you were valuable enough to go after. What he does in these three stories, he illustrates a different type of lost person. That's why he does it in three stories. That in three is a great number to go after, okay? It's a great number of sons. And it's just a great number when you're telling illustrations, okay? So Jesus tells a story about these lost sheep, and what he's illustrating are these lost people that I call wanderers, all right? Now, if you've been in church for any length of time, you've probably seen this. What happens is sometimes that people maybe have followed Jesus for a long time, maybe it hasn't been a long time, but they've kind of walked away from following Jesus, And there hasn't been anything that was like big, like, oh, this pastor didn't do my family's funeral right, or they didn't come visit me when I was sick. It wasn't, you know, something like that. There wasn't even like this big blow up that happened for them to like walk away from Jesus. It was just, they just kind of wandered. It just began to drift. And, you know, maybe it was nobody noticed that they didn't come to church for a couple weeks. And so they just kind of, hey, nobody missed me. All right. And they just kind of wander away. All right, now I said that. Now I have to say this. Did you know that in Scripture, as followers of Jesus, we're called to be under-shepherds of the Good Shepherd of Jesus? So that when people are missing, when people of this, you know, what we call a family, when people are missing, it's our job to notice and say, hey, everything all right? You okay? Because what I know about wanderers is sometimes what happens is they're sick a week, they're gone another week. They're gone another week for whatever reason. Not a single person has said a thing about them not being at church. Oh, okay. Guess nobody missed me. If you were to walk into your house and your spouse were to completely ignore you, or if you were gone for 3 weeks, let's say it this way. If you were gone for 3 weeks and you came back and your spouse was like, you were gone? I'll pray for you. Some of you are laughing a little nervously about that. That's exactly what it is in the church. Sometimes people begin to wander because people are like sheep. People begin to wander. Jesus tells another story. He tells a story about a woman who has lost a coin. Now this, I'll tell you this, I think this woman is a widow, and hopefully you'll see it here in just a second, but let's pick this up here in verse 8. So suppose a woman has 10 silver coins and she loses one. Doesn't she light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? How many ever lost $5 or 20 or more? That's terrible, right? Now see, the best part is when you find $5, right? Isn't that good? You put on a pair of pants and then you find some money in it. Even if it's a quarter, that's just a good day, right? Doesn't that kind of turn your day around? No. You ever put on pants and found a bill? Yeah, that doesn't turn you down. It's the same. Yeah. So verse 9, doesn't she light a lamp, search carefully, and she finds it. And when she finds it, she calls her friends and neighbors together and says, rejoice with me, I have found my lost coin. In the same way, I tell you, there is rejoicing in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner who repents. Now, here's why I think this woman is a widow. There were not a lot of women who would have been the primary breadwinners in their household at this time the scriptures were written. All right, this is a vastly different culture from the one we live in. All right, we live in a culture where there are women who are the primary breadwinners, and there are men who do the same. This is a culture where men were the primary breadwinners, where women didn't have a lot of value, especially if you were a widow. All right. So this woman, she has this money. What we know about a silver coin is it's about a day's wage. So she's worked about 10 days, and now she's lost an entire day's pay. How many of you ever lost something like that? Yeah. Okay, that's bad, right? So she's frantic. She searches for it, and she finds it. See, these are the kind of people, these are the kind of lost people that I call investments. All right, now I'm not a financial person, okay? This isn't about your 401k or 502b or, you know, 8739 something, whatever that is. I don't know what those are, okay? But these are investments. This is a woman who has worked hard for what she has. She's spent time and energy earning that money. And now it's lost. Think about people who you have invested your time, your energy, even some finances in, who have walked away from Jesus. Some of you have been Sunday school teachers in the past. Some of you maybe have worked with student ministries and you've picked up students and you've brought them to church. And maybe you can think of students right now who are no longer following Jesus. Maybe there are people, other people you've invested with or invested into at your workplace who are not following Jesus, and you've invested time into them. That's the second kind of lost people. Then we get to this third story that Jesus tells. This is probably the most common and the most familiar one to all of us. I think even people outside the church are pretty familiar with this story. This is a story of the lost son, the story of a prodigal son. Jesus begins telling this story in verse 11. It says, there was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Now I want you to see something here. I always thought, as I heard this story, that the father just gave the younger son what he was asking for. And that he held on to the rest of it. All right? Because in Hebrew culture, what would happen is when you died as a father, when you could no longer take care of the estate, basically when you were about to die, you would divide what you had amongst your sons. Not always evenly. Usually the oldest son would get a double portion. So congratulations, oldest children. but the younger one comes to his father and says, give me what's mine. Well, what does it say? It doesn't say, so he gave him what he asked for. He divided his property between them. So now the father has not only given his youngest whining son what he's asked for, but he's given away the rest of what he has to his eldest son. You got to read the Bible. The Bible is so cool. Just read it, okay? Verse 13 says, not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country called North Carolina, and there squandered his wealth in wild... Some of you guys are paying attention. That's good. Squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in the whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country. Do you notice he's not hiring himself out to what the metaphor would call another believer? See, his father is a good father. His father represents God in this instance. And his son is gone. He's hired himself out to a citizen of that country. This is in opposition to his father. All right. So these are two opposing forces. So he's given himself essentially away from his father and given himself to a citizen of that country. Essentially what we'd call, sin. Who sent him to his fields to feed pigs, because that's what sin gets you, feeding pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. So he got up and he went to his father. So he has this defining moment. He comes to his senses and he realizes his mistake. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him. Now, his father was not sitting in his lazy boy looking out the window. All right? His father didn't happen to get up and walk past the kitchen window and see, oh, hey, is that my... Oh, yeah, that's my son coming home. The idea that we get from reading this is a father who's standing at the window. He's standing on the porch watching and waiting for his son and hoping that he's going to return. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and had compassion on him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. And his son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you. I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate, for this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So they began to celebrate. This is where the story takes a different turn. We begin to look at the oldest son's role. Meanwhile, the oldest son was in the field. When he came to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked him what was going on. Your brother's come, he replied, and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound. Excuse me. The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, look, all these years I've been slaving for you. I've never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never even gave me a young goat that I could celebrate with my friends. Isn't that the number one complaint you hear amongst teenagers about their parents today? Yep. Gosh, goodness gracious. But when this son of yours who has squandered your property with prostitutes comes home, you killed a fattened calf for him? My son, the father said, you are always with me. Everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he's found. These are what I call the runners. These are people who, for one reason or another, at some point in their life, they've experienced something of who Jesus is. Maybe they've been in the church and something happens and they decide, I don't want anything to do with that. This isn't like the wanderers where they're just kind of like, just kind of gone. These are people who look at what Jesus has to offer and say, no thanks, I'm good. I'm going the complete opposite direction. How many of you have known people like that? Or how many of you, as we read that story, you're thinking, that's me. How many of you, maybe that was your story? That you've been that runner. Speaking of runner, Ray's going to run me some water right now because this is going to get bad if I don't. Thank you, Ray. And thank you, Courtney. Jesus tells a story of a son who thought he knew better than his father. And he shows what the father's response is to both of his sons. To both of his sons, it's a response of compassion and love. What I love about this story is the father doesn't come to him and he's like, okay, let's make a spreadsheet of everything you owe me. Let's make a spreadsheet of everything I gave you. Let's account for it, all right? And you can start paying me back at only 100% interest. That's not what the father does. What does he do? He didn't say a word about that. It's a father who's so overjoyed that his son has come home. He throws a party. There are people like these lost people in our lives. You know people. There are people in your world, maybe who've been wanderers, maybe people who you've invested time in. There are people who are runners in your life. And Jesus begins to tell these stories about them to illustrate something about his priorities. See, God has a little bit different priorities than we do, all right? I know that because we exist, okay? If I were God, we would not exist, all right? If you read the scriptures, and if we had done throughout history what we've done to God, to me, I'm not as cool as God. I'm not as patient as God, all right? I would have wiped us off the face of the earth and left us that way, all right? How many of you would have done the same? Yeah, okay? We're messed up. We're weird, all right? And just downright rude, all right? That's what humans are sometimes. But Jesus shows us God's priorities in this story. Here's what they are. It's making lost people found people and making dead people alive people. That's the entirety of what Scripture is about. Everything that Jesus came to do on this earth was about making lost people found people and dead people alive people. The reason God has been so patient with humanity throughout, history is so that he could make lost people found people and dead people alive people. That's everything. Like, that's it. Like, that. Those words on the screen summed up Scripture. Everything. It's about making lost people found people and dead people alive people. So here's the question that comes into my mind when I read that. What does that say about the priorities of the church? What does that say about our priorities as followers of Jesus and what we call the church? Because you know what? We do lots of events, all right? Now, I'm going to name some things, and I'm not bashing any of these things. I just wanted you to get the lay of the land. We do lots of things. We do lots of dinners, and these dinners have purpose. As a youth pastor, I sit down and I plan a calendar of events and do lots of things. But I'll tell you what. If the end goal of those things is not making lost people found people and making dead people alive people, we've missed the point. We've completely missed the point. Because you know what? There are so many better organizations in the world that are so much better at planning events. There are so many organizations in the world. There are way better bands in the world than the one that we have. personally, I think ours is pretty good, but you know, there's way better musicians in the world. You know what? There's better preachers in the world. And if our goal isn't making lost people found people and making dead people alive people, we've missed the point and we've wasted our time on this earth. Jesus did not come to this earth to tell you how to behave better. He came to make you found. He came to make you alive. It's the entirety of what Jesus came to do. What I love about these stories is it gives us this idea. It's not meant just to kind of bash the church. It's not meant to say that Jesus cares more about lost people than the church. What it tells us is that heaven goes nuts when people come to Jesus. When lost people become found people and when dead people become alive people, heaven goes insane. Like, that's the biggest party. Like, right now, all right, we've sang some great songs, a song like Great Are You, Lord, and we sang, you know, it's your breath in our lungs, all right? God loves hearing that kind of stuff, all right? That warms the heart of God as a father, his children singing to him, telling him how much we love him. That's awesome. God loves that. But what these passages are illustrating is that that pales in comparison to the joy and the party that goes on in heaven when somebody crosses from death to life. Right? If there was a dead person laying here right now, all right? There's a dead person laying here right now, and we prayed, and they came back to life, you tell me you're going to go home and you're going to talk about the sermon? I don't care how good it was. It was not that good. All right? It was not as cool as seeing a dead person come back to life. All right? That's the way heaven looks at what we do. God looks at us and he says, this is great. I love hearing you sing. I love that you're doing these events and some people are going to come to the church because of it. But what I really love, what really bends the heart of God is making lost people found people and making dead people alive people. You're going to wake up in the middle of the night and you're going to have that phrase running through your head. And I'm so sorry about that, but kind of not really. So what's that tell us not only about our church priorities, but about us personally? Everything Jesus was about that right there. Everything Jesus was about making lost people found people and making dead people alive people. Doesn't that kind of put things in perspective? When is the last time you helped somebody go from being lost to being found? And I'm not talking giving them directions to Texas Tavern, as good as it is. When is the last time somebody, because of you, came to know Jesus? Their life was forever changed. Can I tell you this? We did a study when I was in college in one of my classes about what had the most spiritual impact on people. And there's about 100 people that have been surveyed. And do you want to know what the very dead last thing on that list was? Things that had the most spiritual impact on them. You know what it was? A sermon. Like dead last. There was 2 people out of 100 that had said that. Dead last. So this is a class full of, you know, future pastors reading this. Like, oh, that's cool. That's good. Dead last. The least impactful thing of 100 people we surveyed was a sermon. All right, now as much as I like to stand up here and yell and I like to think that, like, hey, I'm going to say something and your life is going to be forever changed. It happens, but not to everybody. You know what the top 3 things were? The common denominator between the top 3 things that had the most impact on a person's spiritual life? They were relationships with people that they knew. I think the number 1 was a family member, like a parent. Others were friends, and others were coworkers. How many of you have family? How many of you have friends? How many of you have coworkers? Do you know the way that Jesus primarily interacts with the world is through the church? Like, God's number 1 instrument on the church or in the world isn't, like, you know, pastors standing up and yelling at people. It's the church. It's people who love Jesus finding people who are lost. One of the preachers I love listening to, he's got this saying that's going to keep coming back into your head. He says it this way. He's talking about Christians sharing Jesus with people. He says, found people, find people. Found people, find people. It means those who have had their lives changed, they're the ones that are going out and helping to change other people's lives. Again, how many of you, if there was a dead person laying right here and they came back to life, how many of you would not go tell people about that? Some of you are thinking, oh, I need to examine the body and make sure that this was real. First of all, make sure this wasn't just a trick or an illustration by the pastor to make a point. That's just weird, okay? I would not do that. I've done some weird things, but nothing that weird. What does this tell us about our priorities? There's another verse I want you to see. It's Colossians 2, verses 13 through 15. It says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. Found people, find people. He forgave all your sins, or all our sins. Having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us, he's taken it away, nailing it to the cross. Now here's my absolute favorite part, verse 15. Having disarmed the powers and authorities, all right, that would be like Satan and the demons, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them on the cross. You know what that means? Is that not only did Jesus forgive you of your sins and give you an opportunity for new life, he made hell and sin look foolish when he did it. That's what Jesus did for you and me. So maybe you're here this morning and you're thinking, you know what? Found people do find people, and I need to start finding people. Maybe you're one of those found people. Maybe there are people in your life that you know need Jesus. And that for whatever reason, maybe it's fear, maybe it's anxiety, whatever it is, that you haven't taken that step to introduce them to Jesus and begin taking steps to show them the love of Jesus. What I would challenge you with this morning is just that thought. Found people, find people. That's what Jesus was about. It's the mission of God on this earth. It's to make lost people found people and dead people alive people. Maybe you're here this morning and you're one of those lost people. Maybe you're living in opposition to God. Maybe you're a runner. Maybe you're a wanderer. Maybe somebody's invested their time into you and you're kind of living in opposition to God. Well, can I tell you, there's great news. The great news is that God is a father who's standing on the porch waiting for you to come home. He's ready to throw a party because you are going to turn from your sin and begin to follow him. This is not a God who's like ready to make a spreadsheet of everything you owe him. What's verse 14 say? Having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness. Means your debt's been paid. All the sins, all the mistakes you've made, Jesus wiped them out. And all God is waiting for, is, as a father, is he's standing on the porch waiting for you to say, I messed up. I'm coming home. So if that's you, we're going to sing a song. This is a song called No Longer Slaves. And as we sing this song, if that's you, if you've never surrendered your life to Jesus, if you've never placed your faith and your hope in him, if you've never asked him to forgive you of your sins, I'd love for you just to do that as we sing this song. This can be a really personal time. If you want to come and kneel at this altar, if you want to stand, if you want to sit, that's all well and good. But this is a time where we want you to connect with God. Do you know what this song says? It says, I'm no longer a slave to fear or sin. I'm a child of God. That's exactly what we become when we cross from death to life, when we place our faith and our hope in Jesus. God is not standing in heaven with a lightning bolt. He's standing in heaven with open arms, ready to receive you back home. So let me pray for you, and then we'll sing.